Good evening, listeners. Tonight, WJMU, in conjunction with the Millikan University School of Theater and Dance, proudly presents Holiday Ham with Kat and Mar. And now, here are your hosts, Katie Tchaikovsky and Mary Elty.
Hi, everybody.
Hi.
I'm Katie.
And I'm Marielle. Welcome to our show.
You know, this is kind of exciting. I've never hosted a radio show before.
Me either. I mean, we have our YouTube channel, but that's like just us being us. So there's no script to it, you know?
Yeah, and here we have to introduce sketches and everything's kind of rigidly planned. So it's a new experience, but I think it'll be fun.
Me too. Oh, you poor damn fools.
Oh, hey, it's one of the cast members, Aria Hawkins. Hey, Aria.
Hey, listen, it's only the beginning of the show. It's not too late. Get out. Get out while you still can.
What are you talking about?
You don't know what doing these shows can do to a person. I've been in every comedy production on this station for 2 years now. I did OST. I did Transportation the Marmoset. I did Turn Your Dial to Murder. Let me tell you something. Doing these shows does things to you. It chips away at your sanity. It's like there's a curse on these shows. Something always goes wrong. Someone gets knocked unconscious, or an expensive piece of equipment gets broken, or every single bit in the show bombs. I don't want you going through what the rest of us have gone through. If you value your sanity, for God's sake, run out that door and never come back.
I think you're exaggerating just a little bit.
Oh no, she isn't. Every word she said was the God's honest truth.
Hey, it's Emily Bowes.
You don't have to introduce each new person that comes up to talk to you. Frankly, it's a little corny.
Sorry, I'm still new to this.
It's cool. Anyway, heed our warning and save your mortal souls. Look what these shows have done to Brian Barker.
How do you do, ladies? Is everything okay over here? I heard a lot of commotion, so I came over to check it out.
Oh no, Emily, Brian's always been like that.
I'll have you know that doing these outrageous accents is a coping mechanism. I do it whenever I'm distressed. Or hungry.
You see? You see what we're trying to say?
I don't know, Kat. Maybe we should listen to them.
Hey, we've been through worse ordeals. If we can survive Chelsea Sunrise, we can survive this.
You. You survived Chelsea Sunrise.
Yeah, but you helped.
Aww.
Well, if you two are so determined to go through with this, then good luck to you. And may whatever deity you worship have mercy on your souls.
Thanks. Hey, Mar, want to introduce the first sketch with me?
Sure. So during this time of year, people like to throw parties with their friends. You know, little get-togethers with snacks and stuff.
Sometimes, though, if the guest list is big enough, you may have to deal with somebody you're not too wild about.
So I stepped back to see where it landed, and I stepped on it.
Oh no!
I just squashed that ping pong ball completely flat, and wouldn't you know it, that was the last ping pong ball they had!
Oh, that is so you, Kylie.
Yeah. So anyway, that's why I'm not allowed at Target anymore.
This has been a really great party, Kylie.
The perfect holiday party.
Thanks, you guys! Brad and I worked so hard on planning this, right, honey?
Oh yeah, this woman was cooking up a storm this afternoon, making the spinach dip and all that.
This is really good spinach dip, by the way.
Thanks! It's my mom's recipe.
Oh my god. Guys, look over there.
What? What is it?
It's that weird kid Zebulon.
Oh my god. No, please no. He is the worst!
Oh, come on, Kylie. He's not so bad.
He's insufferable, Brad! Every word out of his mouth is about some odd conspiracy theory or another. And what the hell kind of name is Zebulon, anyway? It's like some weird alien name or something.
Actually, Zebulon comes from the Bible. He was the sixth son of Jacob and Leah and the founder of the tribe
Liam,
of...
shut up.
Look, Kylie, Zeb's not a bad guy. He's just a little... eccentric. Besides, I figured this might be a good opportunity for him to make some good friends.
You invited him here?
Kylie, I
won't forget this, Brad. I won't forget this as long as I live. You have ruined this party!
Come on now, the party hasn't been ruined. Look, Zeb's already making friends. See him talking to Becky Swanson over there?
No. Every single source I've looked into says that Robert De Niro couldn't have possibly gone to Malaysia disguised as Carol Burnett to pants the Spanish ambassador. They say he was busy filming a movie. But then why did he have that wig in his dressing room? Why did he have the wig? Now, I have a theory.
I can't take it anymore! I just can't take it! Come on, Jared, let's get out of here.
But I, okay. Okay, so maybe he's not the best at mingling, but that's no reason to dismiss him entirely. He's really a cool guy once you get to know him.
I want him out of our house, Brad, before he drives any more of our guests away.
Oh, Lord, he's coming this way. Listen, me and Liam are going to go over and say hi to Araceli and them. Best of luck.
No, guys, don't leave us alone with him.
Look, it's not that we don't want to help you deal with Zebulon. It's just that we don't want to help you deal with Zebulon. See you in a bit.
Come back here, you cowards.
Hey, Kylie. Hey, Brad. Yo, thanks for inviting me to this party. I am having a great time.
At least someone still is.
Kylie. We're glad you're enjoying yourself, Zeb.
I really like this spinach dip. Where'd you get it?
I made it myself, actually.
You did? What kind of spinach did you use?
Oh, I used fresh spinach. It's one of my mom's.
No, I mean, like, what brand did you use?
Well, I don't really know. Like I said, I bought it from the store.
What store?
Kroger's. Why?
Oh, no. Oh, this isn't good.
What are you talking about? It's just spinach.
You don't know? About the company Kroger's gets its spinach from?
Brad, I'm gonna kill him.
Calm down, Kylie. Let him talk.
Brad!
So, I've been doing some digging, and it turns out that Kroger's gets its spinach from Ainsworth Farms, which is owned by a guy named Claude Ainsworth, who married this lady named Marcia Henderson, whose son used to date this woman named Kathy Ann Wakefield, who's friends with my old biology teacher from high school, Mr. Freeman, whose son Jake is dating a guy named Danny Lawrence, who has the same last name as Vicky Lawrence, who is in The Fox and the Hound 2 with Reba McEntire, who is in Tremors with Kevin Bacon, who's become a commercial spokesperson for the egg industry.
And this matters why?
Don't you understand? Eggs come from chickens, and chickens are the primary ingredient in Popeye's chicken sandwiches.
I mean, I should hope so.
Brad!
Do you see what I'm getting at here?
No, I don't, and I don't particularly care to find out.
What it means is that Popeye's chicken sandwich is a part of an elaborate plot by the egg industry to distract people from the fact that Kanye West, Justin Bieber, and the entire Mormon Tabernacle Choir have all been replaced by pod people. And Ainsworth Farms, oh, they're in on the plot, meaning each pound of spinach you buy from Kroger's funds their devious schemes. Now, I know what you're thinking.
Get out.
Huh?
Get out of my house. Now.
Kylie.
I want you out of my house, you... You creep!
Kylie! I am so sorry, Zeb.
It's okay. This happens to me a lot. Not many people are mentally ready to hear the harsh truths about the world.
Ow!
Ah, okay!
Oof.
Oh, I'm so sorry. Jeez, I made you drop your food.
It's okay. I was gonna throw it out anyway. I overheard you talking about Ainsworth Farms. I think it's disgusting the things they're doing. Did you know that Ainsworth Farms kidnapped Tupac?
No. I didn't know that.
Oh, yeah. They kidnapped him and then faked his death. Tupac's alive, and he's chained up in one of Ainsworth's factories. They force him to write ads for them.
That is awful. Say, what do you say we blow this joint and go someplace where there aren't any judgmental people or government spyware?
Where?
My place?
Okay.
Oh, have you heard about what the mattress moat has been doing to all the pigeons in our city?
The daytime talk show is a proud American tradition that has spread all over the world. Even the jolly folks up in the North Pole have their own daytime talk shows.
It's time now for At Home with Mrs. Claus.
Hello, and welcome to At Home with Mrs. Claus. Today, I'm going to be teaching you some festive recipes like homemade gingerbread cookies, oven-baked reindeer legs, and saddleback snow seal soup. I'll also be teaching you some fun arts and crafts like paper snowflakes, construction paper mistletoe, and artificial elf ears. And later, I'll share some Claus family secrets that you won't want to miss. But first, we're going to take some calls from some of our viewers. So snuggle up, grab a cup of cocoa, and stay tuned. Looks like we already have our first caller. Hello, caller.
Hi, Mrs. Claus. My name is Jen, and I'm from Idaho.
Hello, Jen. How are you?
I'm fine, Mrs. Claus. I have a question about the factory elves who make the toys.
I'd be happy to answer it. We here at the North Pole employ more elves than any other business in the world.
Right. I was just wondering, how are the elves paid?
Well, I don't think that's something that I can disclose on the air.
Well, can you confirm whether they're getting paid at all? My website is publishing an article about the wrongful treatment of underpaid elf workers, and I was...
Whoops! Looks like we got disconnected. Not to worry. My producer, Tingles, is telling me we have another caller on the line. Tingles, why don't you come out here and tell everyone how great the elves are treated here at the North Pole?
Yeah, it's great.
Aw, you see that? Thank you, Tingles. Caller 2, you're on.
Hi, this is Dan from Wyoming.
Hello, Dan, and happy holidays.
Thank you. I'm a huge fan. I tune in every week. I just have a quick question about one of your recipes.
Sure, go right ahead.
Did you say oven-baked reindeer legs and snow seal soup?
Why, of course. Those are traditional Claus family recipes.
So you're telling me that you eat reindeer every year? Don't you employ reindeer to pull your husband's sleigh?
Well, yes. But sometimes the reindeer get old and they're not as strong as they used to be, so we have to let them go.
Let them go into the wild?
Well, not exactly. You see, they've been domesticated their whole lives. They couldn't possibly survive in the wild.
So you eat them?
Yes, but only after a couple of years when they slow down.
So, you're telling me that you breed your reindeer, train them and work them for 2 years, and then kill them and eat them? Yeah, call me insane here, but I think that's a little bit inhumane.
Oh my goodness, would you look at that! Tingles is telling me it's already time for a commercial break. Well, stick around, everyone, and when we come back, I'll teach you how to make my world-famous gingerbread cookies.
J'accuse, Madame Claus!
What the hell?
For centuries, your family has encouraged the wanton genocide of the gingerbread people, and today is your day of reckoning! Gingerbread men, attack!
Tingles, help me!
Sorry, lady. I'm Switzerland in this conflict. Peace out, Girl Scout.
Tingles, don't leave me! Somebody help me, please! Ah! Oh, cut to commercial!
For a lot of people, one of the most enjoyable parts of the holiday season is the music, Christmas carols in particular. But of course, there's always one or two people who take it a little too far. I don't know about you, but I sometimes wonder what leads people to be so obsessed with Christmas carols.
Hello, everybody. How are you? My name is Chris, and I'll be your counselor during these sessions.
Hello, Chris.
What's up, Chris?
All right. Now, let's get down to...
We wish you a Merry Christmas. We wish you a Merry Christmas. We wish you a Merry...
Now, judging by that admittedly beautiful four-part harmony, I don't believe you all know exactly why you're here.
Oh, we know why we're here, Chris. We know all too well.
We didn't even plan that harmony. It just happened.
That's all right, Amanda. Now, just so I'm sure we're all on the same page, I want to hear from you guys why it is you're here.
We're here because we're addicted to caroling. There. You happy?
Yes, Harold. I am. And you know why? Because admitting you have a problem is the first step to fixing it.
We don't have the problem. It's our families that have the problem.
Now, Harold, you must admit that randomly bursting into Good King Wenceslas in the middle of your Aunt Frida's funeral isn't exactly normal or constructive behavior.
So they told you about that, huh? Look, it was her favorite Christmas carol.
Is that why you chose that particular song?
Well, I didn't exactly choose it. It just came out.
And when was that funeral, Harold?
May 13th.
You see? You see the negative effect this is having on your lives? Now, Amanda, what is it that made you decide to join us here?
It started in high school. I never thought it could happen to me. I was young. I had my whole life ahead of me, but then MAME happened.
MAME? I'm a little confused here.
It's a musical. My high school did a production of it last year. I played trumpet for it. There's this song in it, We Need a Little Christmas. It's low-key a bop. And it's also the song that started me on my downward spiral. All throughout rehearsal, I'd find myself singing that song to myself randomly. I kept doing it even after the show had closed. Eventually, I moved on to the harder stuff. The Andy Williams Christmas album. My friends won't even speak to me anymore. They say Christmas carols have taken over my life, and I know they're right. I just don't know what to do about it.
Well, coming here was definitely a step in the right direction. We are here to support and guide you through this.
Thank you.
Now, Joyce, what brought you here?
Well, Chris, caroling has ruined my life. I lost my job. My husband left me. My kids no longer speak to me. My cat ran away. When will it end?
It's okay, Joyce.
It started out as a fun family thing. Me, Ma, Colin, the kids. Some years my sisters would join us. But then I lost all sense of proportion. I started creating elaborate 5-part vocal arrangements for us. Then my sisters moved to Florida. My oldest, Kenny, joined the Marines. And Ma joined the Church of the Subgenius. So it was just me, Colin, and our youngest, Vicky. The sound started to suffer. I'd never realized how much my mother had been carrying our group. She's an operatically trained soprano, you know. Anyway, I started hounding the two of them. We'd pull all-nighters learning our new parts. I had no idea I was pushing them away. Now my baby girl is a Wiccan and my husband's shacking up with an insurance sales lady. If only I'd known.
It's okay, Joyce. Just know that we are here to support you and help you on this journey. You're already in a much better place than you were yesterday. I can't say for sure if you'll reconcile with your family, but I'll be hoping for it as long as you are.
Thank you.
Logan, you've been pretty quiet. Would you like to share what brought you here?
Me? I just came here to pick up chicks. I think caroling is stupid.
You take that back, you son of a bitch! Christmas carols are the backbone of this country!
Harold. No, they're not. And I think you know that.
You're right. I just still resent the fact that I'm here.
Well, since there's only two girls here and neither of them are in my age range, I'm just gonna yeet on out of here.
That might be best.
Deuces!
For we need a little Christmas right this very minute.
Amanda.
Sorry, what he said kinda got to me.
I understand that. Well, I think this has been a very successful meeting. The three of you have all begun your healing journey, and you know that no matter what happens, you are not alone. You have me, and you have each other. I think we can call it a night.
Silent night.
Joyce.
Joy to the world.
Amanda.
Good King Wenceslas, look down.
Harold. This may take a little longer than I thought. Well, see you all next week.
We will now pause for station identification, followed by a brief message from one of our sponsors.
You're listening to WJMU 89.5, The Quad.
Southbeat presents some happenings.
Season's greetings! Steve Kronenberg here with a hodgepodge of holiday happenings to keep you warm these dismally drafty December days. Good God, I love alliteration. Want to celebrate the holidays in style? Well, if by in style you mean in a dark, dingy bar that smells faintly of vomit, then come on down to the Pickled Piper. There you can give yourself the greatest gift of all. Absolutely no idea what you did last night. And be prepared to be visited in the middle of the night by three spirits: Johnny Walker, Jim Beam, and Jack Daniels. That's the Pickled Piper, located at 805 South Franklin. It's the grand re-reopening of the Squash at their new location, and they're pulling out all the stops. The halls are decked with boughs of holly, and that's not all that's gonna get decked. Stick around for the confrontation between two drunken frat boys arguing over who sucks more, the Detroit Lions or the Dallas Cowboys. It'll be a thrilling 30 seconds of fisticuffs, followed by 2.5 hours of the two of them crying in each other's arms. Mention the promo code WJMU at the door and get a free boot to the groin. That's the Squash at its new location at 341 North Main Street. All this month, the Dipsomaniac Lounge is moderately proud to present the music stylings of Kenny Velour and the Smooth Tones. Starting at 9 o'clock, this quintet of fat, balding accountants in their 60s with delusions of grandeur serenades you with poorly arranged a cappella renditions of beloved Christmas classics, all while dressed in the cheesiest white tuxedos that Cheapskate Charlie's Tux Rental has to offer. That is, until 10 o'clock, when Dipsomaniac Lounge mainstay Kelly Boom Boom Lafarge takes over the stage with her musical tribute to Patti LaBelle. If Patti LaBelle were a middle-aged white woman in a cheap wig, reeking of elderberry wine, and going on long, meandering tirades about the Japanese, it's a show that'll have you saying, "Where are her background singers?" That's the Dipsomaniac Lounge, located on the corner of Main and Main in downtown Decatur. This is Steve Kronenberg. For more information, call the Stuff Beat Dictaphone at 555-STUFF-IT.
And we're back. You're listening to Holiday Ham with Kat and Mar. Earlier this week, the city council of a nearby town had its last scheduled meeting of the year. I'm not entirely sure why we're doing a sketch about it, but here it is anyway.
And now we begin our final town hall meeting until after the holiday season. At this time, I would like to remind the City Council members of my upcoming Christmas party this Saturday evening. Tickets are $100. If you know where to get them, you know.
Wait, $100 tickets?
Hey now, there's lots of other legislative hangouts you can attend.
No, wait, that sounds like pay to play. There's gotta be something in the charter about this.
Ugh, liberals. Always flouting parliamentary process.
Ain't that the truth?
And with this meeting now in session, we open the floor to local speakers who have taken their time to come and express their concerns and desires for our community.
Are we seriously going to ignore the fact
that— Would our first speaker please step up to the podium and introduce themselves?
Hello. My name is Shania Tweedy, and I have bipolar disorder. I want to talk to the City Council today about their handling of funds earmarked for anti-discrimination laws and mental health treatment. While I feel that this town has followed through on its promise to set money aside for this, as a poor member of the community, why am I not seeing any tangible changes in access to care?
Hi there, you. We're so glad you're here today. Thanks again for bringing attention to all the wonderful things this current council has approved and set aside funds for.
But what about how it's being spent?
Thank you so much for speaking on the quality of care this council has provided for the less fortunate and maligned in our community.
But I— Look, Shania, I'm going to be blunt with you here. Most of the choices this council has made regarding the funds towards improving life for those with mental health issues, choices which I must say I disagree with wholeheartedly, were made to be on the books but not enforced. Now, I've been trying to introduce newer, more effective ideas on how to implement this funding,
and that's all the time we have for our first speaker. Next speaker, please.
Hello, my name is James Harper, and I would like to just say that I have completely lost faith in this council's ability to follow through on its promises to its constituents. All throughout this past year, we have heard promise after promise about increased transparency, accountability, and more dialogue with the public. I personally feel, along with many other people in this city, that the failure of the current board to listen to residents is inexcusable. What do you have to say for yourselves?
Hey now, we listen. We changed the curtains in here, didn't we?
That doesn't really address my concerns.
And that's all the time we have for Mr. Harper. Next speaker, please.
You know, I think the way you're conducting this meeting is absolutely shameful.
Let the record show, tough Rockos.
Of course.
Next speaker, please.
Hello,
My name is Timothy Harrison, and to build on what Mr. Harper said, I just so happen to be a lawyer, and I've done some digging, and it seems that a lot of the new policies the City Council has been trying to implement seem to be designed to basically rob the public blind. It really seems like you're abusing the public trust.
Thank you for voicing your concerns, Mr. Harrison. You see, in this great country, we are built upon feedback from our constituency. And on our website is a list of our recent accomplishments if you'd like to see what we've done so far for the community.
That really doesn't answer my question.
As my colleague said, if you would only look at the website, you would see all the progress that's been made thanks to our new policies and all the benefits they will have for the city at large.
But...
And that's time. Next speaker, please.
Time, my foot! No one even answered the question.
Next speaker, please.
Hi, my name is Trent. So I've had depression for years, right? And now I am an up-and-coming fashion designer. And I beat my depression, and I'm just so worried about this city, you know? Like, I feel like I'm putting in my fair share. I am an up-and-coming fashion designer, and I want the city to be number one, you know? I'm just worried that other people aren't putting in their fair share. Again, a fashion designer, and I just want this city to be number one. Up-and-coming designer.
Well, Trent, I'm glad to hear you're doing so well in your career, but just saying do things to people isn't exactly helpful. Now,
if I could, I would also like to congratulate the young man on his success. I think you're working very hard to make this city great, and you deserve not to pay taxes.
What?
And you're right. Other citizens in this town really aren't pulling their weight, and it's high time they started.
Thanks, Dad.
Now, hold on a second.
Time. Next speaker, please.
Hi. My name is Katrina, and I'm in the sixth grade. I was wondering, why do we continue to cheat our poor, disabled, and sick?
Well, thank you, little girl, for your heartfelt, thought-provoking question. But that is a very complicated issue, and I'm afraid we don't have the time to really get into it right
now. Bullcrap! Katrina, you're right. Our government is still failing many of its citizens. Now, the Progressive Party is trying to rectify that by...
Oh, boo the Progressive Party. You all think you're so great with your college degrees, while I, for one, am sick of you trying to indoctrinate our youth with your cockamamie socialist ideas.
Since when did educating yourself and others to try and help improve our society become a bad thing?
Oh, you wish you were improving society, you pinko commie pieces of...
And that's all the time we have for public speakers this evening. At this time, the meeting will continue in a closed-door setting. I hope to see all of you invitees at my Christmas party, especially Jen with that beautiful glazed ham she always makes. The next public meeting will be sometime mid-January. I hope to see some of you there. Meeting adjourned.
When I was a kid, I used to love going to the mall at this time of year to see Santa. Of course, I don't think I was half as excited for it as this kid is.
Ding dong, ding dong, hear the bell ringing out the first Noel.
Ladies and gentlemen, the Hilton Hills Mall will be closing in 15 minutes. We thank you for shopping at the Hilton Hills Mall. Please begin to make your final purchases at this dying place of commerce. Thank you for coming in and touching things with your grubby little fingers before buying them online.
Mom, look! Santa's still here! Can we go see him?
Whatever. Anything that brings me a brief respite from the constant pain that is raising you, my child.
Thanks, Mom! You're the best! Santa, 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 Santa!
Ho, ho, ho! Merry Christmas, little one!
Hi, Santa.
What's your name, son?
My name's Milo.
And what would you like for Christmas, Milo?
Well, I want a new baseball mitt, some Hot Wheels, a stuffed lizard, a trip to the North Pole, and I want my mother to pay for her insolence.
Come again?
The matriarch refuses to pledge allegiance to you, Santa, as I have. She does not believe in you, my lord, and must be made holy in your eyes.
That's not a very nice thing to say. That might get you put on the naughty list.
You're right.
It isn't nice to wish ill upon others, even if they are heretics. Oh, forgive me, Santa, for I have sinned.
Whoa, kid, cool it.
I beg your eternal forgiveness, oh jolly one.
You're forgiven, I guess.
Oh, thank you, Santa. Oh, thank you so much.
Kid, I think you might have kind of a warped idea as to who Santa is.
Aw, I know exactly who you are, Santa. You're a god.
Oh, no.
The Savior, the Son of Kringle, the light on the tree, come to cleanse the world of all evil.
Look, kid, this is getting uncomfortable. Here, I'm just going to level with you. I'm not the real Santa, see? The beard comes right off.
You removed your thick, mighty beard without having to shave. It came right off. Truly, you are the Messiah. Hallelujah! Amen! Quick, turn this Capri Sun into wine.
What? No.
Oh, you're right. Oh, forgive me, O King of the North. I was wrong to have tested your greatness.
Security!
Please don't send me away, Santa! I've been waiting for this moment for years!
Look, kid, I am not Santa. My name is Steve. And I'm not some godlike being that magically sneaks into your house and leaves you toys. I'm just some regular Joe Schmo who lives in a small apartment in the next town over.
Say it ain't so, your Steveness! Say it ain't so! Don't let down your followers!
What? Followers?
Oh, yes. I've gotten about half my class to accept you as their Lord and Savior. Together, we'll raise up an army and spread your gospel of holly jolliness throughout the globe!
Security!
Oh my God, Milo, are you scaring this poor man with your stories about raising up an army of holly jolliness?
This is no mere man, Mom! This is the great, omnipotent Santa Claus!
Oh, jeez, kid, no!
I am so sorry for this. You're the fifth mall Santa he's done this to. I'm pretty sure the last one had to be committed afterwards. Come on, Milo.
No, Mom, please don't. I must earn Santa's favor.
Come on.
Notice me, Senpai Claus.
God, I need a drink. All right, I'm ready for the next kid now.
He's the man with...
Someone found the lighted house late one night, and he saw through the wind no sight.
We're going to take a quick break now for station identification, followed by a message from another one of our sponsors.
Hi! We'll return you to your program in just a minute, but first, have we got a deal for you?
That we do, Gary. Say, do you like parody music?
You bet! I'm a real big fan of Weird Al Yankovic.
Well, if you love Weird Al, then you'll at least tolerate his non-union equivalent, Manic Mel Hasbrook.
Aw, man, him? I mean, yes indeed. And now you can own this wonderful compilation of some of Manic Mel's greatest hits.
Well, they're not exactly his greatest, more like his least bad.
Yes, well, anyway.
And they're not really hits either,
Shut up so we can get this over with!
Sorry. You'll get all of Manic Mel's least unpalatable musical abominations, like this parody of Billie Eilish's Bad Guy.
So you play good, guys, do just what you should, guys, save the neighborhood, guys, not misunderstood, guys. I play bad types, always act the cad types, make the mayor mad types, might kidnap your dad types. I play bad guys.
Duh. Uninspired. And of course this half-baked parody of Lil Nas X's Old Town Road.
Well, I'm gonna take my car to the old racetrack. I'm gonna ride till the engine bell has no tech. I'm gonna take my car and reach top speed. Cause why ride a horse when you could drive a 600 horsepower machine? It just seems inefficient.
And who could forget his parody of Gautier's big hit, Somebody That I Used to Know, written 7 years too late from the point of view of a disenchanted former child star.
I know I'd like to forget it.
Me too.
You didn't have to rip me up, but you squandered all my pain. Then you ran up and you left me with nothing.
and it feels so rough. Now you're just a bastard who owes me some dough.
So what are you waiting for? Order the least bad hits of Manic Mel today!
Please order it! If we don't sell every single copy, they'll kill our cat!
Save our baby! Buy this album!
The Least Bad Hits of Manic Mel is not sold in stores, and thank God for that.
You're listening to Holiday Ham with Kat and Mar. I'm Kat.
And I'm Mar. You know, something my family likes to do around the holidays is make some hot cocoa, gather in the living room, and watch an old murder mystery.
A what? A murder mystery?
Yeah, it's fun. Sometimes we poke fun at the movie a little, you know, tell jokes about the stuff that happens in it.
That is a weird tradition.
Hey, don't knock it till you try it. I just happened to find a clip from this old film I haven't seen in a long time. You want to watch it with me?
Sure, why not?
Yay! Sorry we don't have any cocoa.
It's fine, I'm allergic to dairy.
Well, it's been quite a long, dramatic evening, but I do believe I've finally gotten down to the bottom of things. Ladies, gentlemen, non-binary individuals, I have determined who it was that killed Mr. Barnaby Evans.
Oh, thank heaven for that. At last, we can put this ghastly night behind us.
Of course you would want to put this night behind you, Mrs. Wilkinson.
Exactly what are you insinuating, detective?
Well, Mrs. Wilkinson, during my investigation, I just so happened to discover that you and Barnaby Evans had been having a secret affair for 4 years prior to this night.
Genevieve, how could you?
It's a lie, Edward. I could never be unfaithful to you.
Really? Then explain this pair of bloomers with your name embroidered on the waistband. They were in Mr. Evans's file cabinet, filed under W for wow.
What have you got to say for yourself, Genevieve?
I'm so sorry, Edward. I was weak.
Tonight just happened to be the night he decided to call it quits. You were incensed. You had given him the best years of your life. You hated him for breaking up with you. You despised him for it.
All right, I admit it. I did hate him for leaving me, but I didn't kill him.
Of course you didn't. You couldn't have possibly killed him. At the time of the murder, you were out in the garden, hacking the rose bushes apart with an axe. Your husband, on the other hand...
Now, just a minute. What possible motive would I have for killing Barnaby Evans? I mean, I didn't know about the affair until just recently.
True. But that wasn't the only wrong that Barnaby Evans had done to you. The two of you were former business partners. He embezzled millions of dollars from the business and then framed you. You spent 3 years in prison for a crime you didn't commit. And prison does things to a man's mind. Makes him bitter.
All right. So he framed me and had me sent to prison. I had every reason to want to see him dead. Even so, I didn't kill him.
Of course you didn't. At the time of the murder, you were outside the bathroom door, tying your shoelaces and waiting for the person before you to finish. Which brings me to Jack Dinsmore.
What? You think I killed him? Detective, I am insulted.
Why wouldn't you want to kill Barnaby Evans? After all, he was blackmailing you.
What's he talking about, Jack?
Nothing, dear.
I wouldn't call trying to extort $500,000 from you in exchange for not releasing compromising photos of you to the press. Nothing, Mr. Dinsmore.
Compromising photos? Photos of what?
Photos of Mr. Dinsmore judging a pie-eating contest 3 years ago and accepting a bribe from one of the competitors. You knew if those photos ever got released to the public, your gubernatorial campaign would be over before it even began. So you needed to guarantee his silence.
All right, so he was blackmailing me. The fact remains that I am innocent.
I know you are, Mr. Dinsmore. You couldn't possibly have killed Barnaby Evans. You were the person in the bathroom Mr. Wilkinson was waiting on. Your wife, on the other hand...
Now wait just a minute, detective.
Don't bother denying it, Mrs. Dinsmore. It's well known that Barnaby Evans was the reason behind your sudden retirement from ventriloquism. He had promised you the lead role in a big play he had been producing, but only on the condition that you give up your ventriloquist act and publicly denounce ventriloquism as being, and I quote, poopy. Then, when you had done it, you found, much to your chagrin, that there was no play. He had simply wanted you out of commission so that he could steal your act and give it to his considerably less talented nephew, Roderick. You've held a grudge against him ever since.
That may be so, but I didn't kill Barnaby Evans.
Of course you didn't, Mrs. Dinsmore. You were also in the bathroom at the time of the murder. with Mr. Dinsmore.
Ew!
Beryl, really?
I'm not proud, but I'd do it again.
Me too, darling, me too.
Good Lord, I have to clean that bathroom.
And that brings us to the maid, Simona. You've worked for Barnaby Evans for 12 years now. You've seen him at his worst, at his absolute most monstrous. You've seen every evil act he has committed, every crime against humanity, every under-the-table deal he's made with certain hostile foreign governments, every Girl Scout he's stolen cookies from. You knew better than anyone what a despicable man he was.
The man was scum. He used to hunt Jehovah's Witnesses for sport.
His favorite hobby, though, was live taxidermy.
Yes. I've seen him lure many an unsuspecting sap down to his laboratory in the basement. Down to their doom. He's skinned and stuffed at least 50 people down in that dungeon of his, including my beloved wife. I tried to warn her. She wouldn't listen.
All the more reason for you to finally rid the world of him, to do humanity a favor.
I won't lie and say I never thought about it, but I didn't do it. Maybe I should have, but I didn't. I didn't kill him!
I know. At the time of the murder, you were washing the dishes, so you couldn't possibly have committed the murder either.
Ugh.
Well, damn it, then who did kill Barnaby Evans?
Yes, Detective. Just please tell us, for God's sakes, who killed Barnaby Evans?
It was me! I did it in the dining room with the lead pipe. Go ahead, check under the floorboards. There you will find his hideous heart. I killed Barnaby Evans, me, and I'm glad I did it. Glad, I tells you, and I'd do it again. Over and over and over again. Round like a circle in a spiral, like a wheel within a wheel. You spin me right round, baby, right round, like a record, baby, round, round, round. Round. You spin
oh
me
dear,
right
that's another
round,
detective
baby,
gone mad.
This is what, five round, now? Round,
why does this keep happening?
I suppose we'll never right learn who round, killed Barnaby Evans.
That's because I'm not dead.
Barnaby Evans!
That's right. I wasn't murdered after all. I was merely pining for the fjords, and you poor dopes went to all the trouble of driving five private eyes insane for nothing.
How horribly anticlimactic. Edward, dear, shoot him.
Yes, dear.
Come, Jack. Shall we go to the bathroom?
Yes, let's.
Oh, no, you don't. Get back here.
Round, round. You spin me right round, baby. Right round.
One of the hardest parts about being in a relationship is getting the relationship started in the first place. You know, letting the person know you like them. It can be very nerve-wracking to open yourself up to another person in that way, especially since you never know how it's going to turn out.
So I told her if she wanted to borrow one of my pens, she could have just asked.
Ugh, I hate people like that, who just take whatever they want. Like Gina Phelps. One time we ran into each other at the Burger Monarchy and she ate my fries. I mean, she
Oh my God, Holly. Look over there.
Where?
Over there, at that counter. Look. It's him.
Who?
That's Cameron Scott. You know, that guy from work I was telling you about earlier.
Oh, so that's the guy you have the hots for. Why don't you go up and talk to him? Maybe ask him out?
What? Oh, Holly, no, I couldn't.
Come on, the worst thing he can do is say no.
That's why I can't do it. I can't handle rejection.
Sure you can. You've been rejected plenty of times.
Not by Cameron Scott. That'd be like getting spat on by God himself. I couldn't handle it, Holly. I just couldn't.
Alicia.
I'd die on the spot.
Alicia.
I'd just die.
Alicia, listen to me. You are a mighty warrior goddess. You are a strong, desirable woman, and any man would be lucky to have you. Now go up to that guy and ask him out.
Okay. Wish me luck. Hi, Cameron.
Hey, Alicia. Fancy seeing you here. How are things going? Alicia? You okay?
Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer had a very shiny nose,
And if you ever saw it, you would even say it glows.
That was pretty nice.
Thanks. I'm gonna go back to my table now.
Okay, see ya.
See ya.
What the hell was that? Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer? No, I know that. I meant, why did you just belt that out like that?
I don't know. It just kind of came out. It's my nerves, I think.
Okay, well, let's try some grounding techniques. Maybe that'll help settle your nerves.
It's worth a shot, I guess.
Okay, close your eyes. Breathe in. Breathe out. Breathe in. Breathe out. Breathe in. Breathe out. Now listen to me. You are a good person. You are fun to be around and worthy of love. I believe in you. You can do this. You ready?
I think so.
Go get him, Tiger.
Hi.
Hey, Alicia. So what is it you wanted to say? Alicia?
Mary, did you know that your baby boy would one day walk on water? Mary, did you know that your baby boy would save our sons and daughters? Did you know that your baby boy has come to make you new? This child that you've delivered will soon deliver you.
Wow. That was really nice.
Thanks. Could you give me a second?
Sure.
I did it again, Holly.
I know, I heard it.
I sang it him.
I know.
Excuse me, miss. Do you take requests?
What?
Do you know Lady of Spain?
Can you not right now? My friend is going through a very difficult time.
My bad. Sorry, ladies. She doesn't take requests, Martha!
Oh, this isn't gonna work, Holly. I've blown it for sure. He probably thinks I'm a freak.
He does not.
He's never gonna speak to me again.
Leash, listen to me. One of the most important keys to success is turning your weaknesses into strengths. So you're gonna use this nervous tick of yours to your advantage.
What are you talking about?
When you go up there this time, pick a romantic song to sing to him.
I'm not going up there again.
Leash, this man could be Mr. Right. You're not gonna know it unless you get back on the horse.
I don't know if I can pick a song. They've just been coming to me.
Just try it. Please?
Oh, okay.
Hi.
Hey.
I'll have a blue...
Oh, Lord.
...Christmas without you. I'll be so blue just thinking about you. Decorations of red on a green Christmas tree won't be the same, dear, if you're not here with me. And when those blue snowflakes...
Okay. I think I'm getting the message. If you want to, like, go out to dinner sometime, I'm free Wednesday at 7. There's this Thai place downtown I've been wanting to try. We could go there. If you're free, I mean.
I'd like that.
Great. Pick you up at 7?
Sure.
Neat. Oh, we better head back to the office.
Huh? Oh, yeah. Don't want Mr. Trumbull on our backs. See you later, Holly.
See you, Leash.
Excuse me, miss? Do you mind if I sat here? There's no other place to sit, and I've been on my feet all day.
No, go right ahead.
Thanks. I promise not to bother you or anything.
It's fine.
Whatever Lola wants, Lola gets. And little man, little Lola wants you.
Make up your mind to have no regrets. Recline yourself, resign yourself, you're through.
We will now pause for station identification, followed by one final message from one of our sponsors.
You're listening to WJMU 89.5, The Quad.
Hey,
Hey, kids, come quick. Your mother and I have a big surprise for you.
Ooh, what is it?
Guess.
Is it a rocket ship powered by cheese?
No.
Is it a pony that can burp rainbows and cry pudding?
No.
Is it a new car?
Now that's just plain stupid, Billy. You're stupid.
Huh. What is it then?
It's an empty cardboard box.
Empty cardboard box? Oh boy!
Yes, it's Empty Cardboard Box, the brand new toy that has kids all over the country jumping for joy.
Look, it's a spaceship. Pew, pew, pew.
Now it's a taxi cab. Where to, buddy? Hurry up, I haven't got all day.
Now it's a life raft. Still no sign of land, and only enough food to last us 2 more days.
It's a bug hunt, man, a bug hunt.
Game over, man, game over. What the heck are we gonna do now?
Empty Cardboard Box stimulates the child's imagination and lets their tiny little minds roam free and explore all the possibilities playtime has in store for them.
Now it's
the Batmobile. Come on, Robin, let's go foil the Joker's evil plan.
Right on, Batman.
Wait, what does that make me?
You're the spare tire.
Dang it, I'm always the spare tire.
And they're fun for the whole family. Even Mom and Dad can enjoy them.
I'm going to destroy your whole city!
Yes, I am evil. Oh no! Who will save us from this fire-breathing monster?
Roar! I am Gamora, protector of children and friend to all mankind. Your reign of terror ends now, Giles.
Yay! We're saved!
So get your kids an empty cardboard box today! Available at your local Wahlbergs or TCB Pharmacy.
And we're back. You're listening to Holiday Ham with Kat and Mar.
I'm Kat.
And I'm Mar.
You know, something I think a lot of people forget sometimes is that Christmas isn't the only holiday being celebrated at this time of year. There's also Hanukkah, Kwanzaa, Yule. Some cultures even celebrate the winter solstice. Let's take a look at a solstice celebration right now.
Hello, everybody. Thank you so much for attending our annual solstice party. It's been a very productive year, full of spookery. As your head witch in charge, I encourage you to mingle, relax, and enjoy. I want to thank each and every one of you for your individual contributions to our coven. Even you too, Lucia and Lucifer.
Thank.
Alrighty, now who brought the Eye of Newt Soup?
I did. It took me hours. I made it from scratch.
Yay, Robin! Thank you very much.
Well, actually, I was supposed to bring the Eye of Newt Soup, and so I brought 3 containers of it.
That's okay, kitty. The more the merrier.
We love soup.
Sure, but actually, that's why I made the sign-up sheet, so that we could avoid these kinds of confusing situations. It was clearly posted on my door, and we were all supposed to sign up for something.
Did anyone use the sign-up sheet aside from you?
No, actually. But I think the principal of it...
I think if the sign-up sheet were in a more public place and not on your door, we could have avoided this.
Actually, my door is a very central place in the office. It makes perfect sense to put it there.
Oh, really? Is it? Are you guys fighting?
No, we are not fighting, Beth.
We love soup.
Oh, shut up, Lucy's.
You guys, stop. You know I can't handle any form of conflict.
All right, all right. Sorry, Beth. Like I said before, girls, the more the merrier. It's the holidays, after all. No need to fight. Why don't we try your soup first, kitty?
Okay, here you go.
Oh, you sure like to use dog's breath. How very fragrant.
Thanks.
Oh, it's very interesting. Why don't you go ahead and try it, Beth?
Okay. Ooh, yum. This is awesome, kitty. I really like it. It's like mucky, but like in a good way, you know, like a good mucky.
This is soup?
Yes, it's soup, but what do you think about it?
This is soup?
No, what do you... Ugh, never mind. You try it, Robin. No, I'm good. Why don't we try mine now?
Sure thing!
Here you go.
Thank you. Oh, Robin. This is the greatest thing I've ever tasted. It's absolutely ravishing, a revelation. I am forever changed, and every other food I've ever had simply pales in its comparison. This is unquestionably better than any other soup I've ever had. Ever. You should be extremely proud of yourself, and every other cook in the world should be unquestionably ashamed.
I'm sure it's not that good.
Oh, wow. This is that good. I think this is helping cure my anxiety. I feel like flying. I feel like I can literally do anything. The world is open to me and I am free.
You guys are being so dramatic.
We love soup.
You really should try it, Kitty.
Fine, I'll try it. Is that good?
Wait, come back, Kitty. Let's talk about conflict resolution and anger problems. Conflict doesn't need to be scary, Kitty. The soup taught me that, Kitty. The magic soup.
Robin, come into my office. I think we should discuss your future in the coven. It's looking very bright.
We love soup!
Well, that's about all the time we have. We hope you enjoyed tonight's special.
We'd really like to thank all of the wonderful ensemble members for their performances tonight, and we'd like to thank you all for tuning in.
We hope you all have a wonderful holiday break. See you guys around.
Before we go, make sure to check us out on YouTube at Cat and Mar, and also make sure to like and subscribe.
Bye.
That was Holiday Ham with Cat and Mar, hosted by Katie Tchaikowski and Mary L. Teep, starring Spencer Avery, Rachel Bonda, Will Barden, Brian Barker, Mackenzie Barnett, Emily Bowes, John D'Angelo, Taylor Eckert, Abigail Goward, Logan Hansen, Aria Hawkins, Peyton Humphreys, Matt Jester, Mickey McNaughton, Alex Naranjo, Ryan Ogden, Michael Santos, Bryn Sentner, and Joshua Witt. This program was written by Brian Barker, Sam Laureau, Frank Macaluso, Alex Naranjo, Nate Polis, Nick Polis, Kendra Steele, Joshua Wick, and Sawyer Walter, and directed and produced by Frank Macaluso. This is your announcer, Jordan Comish, wishing you a safe and happy holiday season.